Welcome to 514.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're here today to talk about the most amazing man. Thousands of years ago, he taught us timeless virtues and lessons, things we should never forget. Here are some of our favorites. Very truly, I tell you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. And very truly, I tell you, before Abraham was born, I am! I have food you know nothing about. By your words, you will be acquitted, and by your words, you will be condemned. Whoever finds their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life for my sake will find it. You will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. If your hand or foot causes you to stumble, cut it off and throw it away. Again, I tell you, it is easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for someone who was rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. I wonder if he hates rich people. Well, that's all today, folks. We'll see you next week for Peace and War.
Thank you so much for being here. We're glad to be with you. We're excited that spring has sprung. Is anybody else excited? I know some of you are still at home and you're watching from there, but we're glad to be with you. I'm glad to feel a little bit of sun shining, right? Thank you guys for giving to the church. Thank you for continuing to be faithful. And there's buckets you can give in if you walk out. There's ways you can give online to our church. So many of you faithfully and consistently give to the church to help us do all the things that we can do. There's so much we could highlight in terms of what your giving does. Last year, we actually started a COVID relief fund, people that were struggling to make ends meet, whatever happened in their life, we gave them an opportunity to reach out. And because of your giving, we were able to give, I think, over $55,000 to people who were struggling in need, that needed to, you know, either make rent payments or buy food or whatever it is, all to people that are right around here, your friends, your neighbors. So, I mean, give yourselves a hand for actually giving to that level that we could do that and help people. And of course, if you're in need, you can continue to reach out to us. Just send us an email. We'd love to help you. And we have so many ministry partners that we give to. We give 10% of our annual budget to several of our ministry partners who are doing things all over the world in places that we are not and places that we can't be, but where there's experts doing great work, from teachers and stuff in Haiti to organizations that help supply water and help women get out of sex trafficking. We really are involved in a lot of different things. So when you give, you're giving to something a lot bigger than what's right in front of you, which is really, really cool. And it's an exciting season for the church because Easter and Good Friday are upon us, or Good Friday and Easter, the time of year where we celebrate the cross and the crucifixion. And also the time where we get to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, which essentially is everything to Christianity. It's everything there is. If it doesn't happen, we're not here. Literally, we're doing something else. We might be gathering in different ways for different reasons. But there's one singular reason that we're all gathered today, and that's because of the resurrection. So those times are upon us. Go jump online. We have tickets, I think, for Easter Sunday. So it's filling up. And I want to encourage you all, please make the journey to make a change in your Sunday morning routine. And if you're watching online, you're thinking about when you're going to come to the Easter service. Our earlier services, there's three on Sunday morning, and the late one, the 1 p.m. one, is not full. So we want you to jump online and get tickets for that. Please come to that one. We actually, I don't think, have much room left in the other two. So if you're going to come to church, you need to go to brunch first or early or something like that, and then come to church late. We have coffee now, so we can keep you awake after you ate. So we want you guys to be a part of that. It's going to be really, really fun at 514 Church to celebrate those amazing things together. And man, this series has just been incredible as it's been kicked off by John and then followed up with a total home run message from Carmen last week as they kind of brought to us these ideas of the words of Jesus and how when we really draw near to them, we really listen to them, and we understand what they do. They're game changers for the way we think. They're game changers for the way that we live. And man, if we really think about it, it is kind of mind-blowing, some of the stuff that Jesus said. And as John told us, like, when we look at Jesus and we follow Jesus and we listen to what he said, it's either going to kind of make us angry, or it's going to make us frustrated and run away, or it's going to make us disappointed, or it's going to make us kind of like completely flip our world upside down, or we're going to be totally astonished and totally amazed at what Jesus had to say, almost to the point where when we look at what Jesus had to say, a lot of times it's difficult to actually digest, and we just decide not to altogether. And we say, I don't want to deal with that. And we think maybe these words don't matter for me. And we might even, rip them out of our Bible, if we will, in a proverbial sense. We're not in. We're not going to follow him. If he said that, then I'm not in. And then Carmen talked about how incredible it is that God is actually our life source, that we go looking everywhere else to fill up our lives, to give us everything we need. And she told us last week, like when Jesus said that he's the bread of life, that we're talking about the answer to the eternal desires and the needs that we have. And if we go to him, he fills us up. He actually does. That alone is something to just camp on for the rest of your life. To just think about the truth that Jesus is your life source. He fills you up. And that also nothing else will. Nothing else will satisfy you fully. Maybe for a moment. Just like candy, sweet in the mouth, bitter in the belly. Such are all the things that we try to fill up our lives with. Decent for a moment, but fleeting. God sustains us. Every day he fills us. Every day we need him. What an incredible thing to think about. And today, I'm going to look at two parts of Jesus's words and things that he said, where when you listen to him, you go, huh? He said, what? What is he saying? What is he doing? What is Jesus up to when he's talking the way that he's talking? And my question for you all is, as church starts to open up and people are coming back, dedicating children like we did today, we're starting to move through the world a little more than we have been for the past year, is the church ready to stand up and be all that it's supposed to be? Are we ready to do what it means and takes and requires of us to be God's church? Do you know what it even means to be God's church? Is church something that you go to, or is church something that you become? Is it bigger? Do you know? Do you think that church is a building? Do you think that church is just this moment, a worship service? Jesus gives us a lot of insight into what it means to be the church, and we're going to look at where he kind of talks about that for the first time, where he kind of decides that he's going to make a church and what all that means. But for us, when we think about church, are we ready to start to do some of the things that church looks like? Are we ready to serve? Are we ready to be involved in church again? Are we ready to get together and be in small groups? Are we ready to, do some crazier things that not the whole world understands? That we give our money, that we serve other people, we serve those that are in need, that we welcome all types of people into this building, that we maybe get up early and serve to make a Sunday morning experience go well for kids, that maybe we get up early and we're on a parking team, that there's all kinds of ways that we can get involved and we can be the church. We can be his gathering of people who are Christians, which means we're little Christs. We're followers of Jesus. We're doing life the way that Jesus has led us, and we want to exemplify him into the world. Are we ready to start listening and be humble? Are we ready to pray more? Are we ready to be all that God has called us to be? Are we ready to understand more what our neighbor is going through? Are we ready to have that soft heart and engage our neighbor? I mean, it's funny, right, with the spring and things changing as they are with COVID and people starting to open up and leave the house a little more. I feel like I have new neighbors. Anybody seen their neighbors for the first time, like, ever? Like, we have this great neighbor across the street named Wendy, and she lives right across the street. I haven't seen her for like 3 months. Wendy! It's like she was on vacation somewhere. She was just at home. And, like, that's the way it is, right? Are we ready to, like, engage people and be the church and be the kind of people that God has called us to be disciples? Kind of an intense word, right? Are we ready to be disciples of Jesus and learn and follow him and ask God to transform us from the inside out. Ask God to do that seed work in our hearts and souls. That is the only way that we can bear the fruit. That means lots of time in prayer. That means lots of time in contemplation. That means kind of stirring up the gift of the Spirit of God inside of our hearts. Like, it's all a lot. And that's what God has called us to. And when you say that Jesus is your King, that's a big deal. And I want to remind you, like, calling Jesus King, following him, that's massive. To really say, I'm going to be your follower, I'm going to call you King, I'm going to be like a follower of you, that's a really, really big deal to make that commitment. There's a natural desire for all of us to be led. And Jesus becomes the only King that's really ever been worth following almost in the history of the world. One of the reasons we have an American democracy is because of the failure of kingships, monarchies all throughout history. It doesn't work. Typically, any nation that has become great is not great because they've had a necessarily great king, a benevolent king, but because they've won lots of wars and made lots of money and taken over lots of land and dominated and overpowered. And Jesus says, I'm your King. And when he starts out his ministry, he actually says, repent, the kingdom of heaven is near. He said, what? The kingdom of heaven is near? The kingdom of heaven is near. Jesus is doing ministry and he's walking around and he says, repent, the kingdom of heaven is near. And you know what he's getting at? He's saying, the kings and the things and the gods that you follow, they're going to destroy you. And they use swords and they use power and they overlord people and dominate them. And you kind of just get what you get with them. You get destroyed because you live by the sword. You die by the sword. You need to turn away from the kingdoms of this world. And you need to start to look at my kingdom. And it's near because I'm here. The kingdom of God is near because Jesus came to earth. So it was near when Jesus was here. Then this crazy miraculous thing that some of us hear about and we go, huh? He left and then he gave us a version, another version of himself in the fashion of a Holy Spirit that lives inside of the followers, the followers of Jesus. And so the kingdom of God is not just near, it's here. It's like starting right here in me. So, that, I mean, that's a sermon all in of itself. Repent, the kingdom of God is near. Calling Jesus King is huge. It means you're going to follow him. It means you're going to bring a totally different way you think about people, a different way you think about money, a different way you think about relationships, a different way you think about your body, what your body is, what it means, how God made you. The kingdom of heaven is near. Something different, something better. It's near. And I think a lot of us go through life, and this is one of the things I'm going to hit on in Easter. A lot of us go through life thinking that God's whole plan is to get not the kingdom near, but to get me out of here. Some of us grew up in church where we think that like God's whole plan is to take us out of here and throw us into a place called heaven one day, where we walk on the streets of gold and waltz by the crystal sea, and we sit on clouds with harps. I've never played a harp in my life. You ever seen someone play a harp? It's like you have to get a PhD to play the harp. I don't want to do that for eternity on a cloud with a loincloth on. Not me. And Jesus says, behold, the kingdom, repent, the kingdom of heaven is near. The way the world works stinks. When I lead the world, and if you follow me, that's the way it's supposed to be. Your heart transformed, loving, soft, tender, peace-filled, bringing holiness and goodness and creative prowess and love and joy into this beautiful world. That's what you want to be a part of, and bringing it here. You know, the ultimate plan is that the kingdom of God's coming here. He's going to redo this, and it's going to be better, but it's going to be here. The kingdom of heaven is here. He didn't say, I came here to take you there. He said, I came here as the beginning of something that's going to come to full maturation one day. So our bodies are going to be transformed. This earth is going to be transformed. And it's going to look like Jesus did when he rose from the dead, but just better and able to walk through walls. I mean, doesn't that sound exciting? It's something that happens here, and it's happening in us right now. So saying that Jesus is king is massive. It's a massive thing to give your allegiance to God, to declare, to follow him. It's a big deal. And in living as though he is your king is an even bigger deal. And what Jesus does in this passage, that when you hear it, you're going to be, what did he say? He said that. He said what? He said this? Is this whole idea of like forming you and me to be an extension and to bring goodness into the world through you and me. This is the passage we're going to look at where he kind of sets all this up as the body, the following, the gathering of people that we are today. He sets it all up for us. So this is in Matthew 16. It's going to be up on the screen. And Jesus has taken his disciples on a two-journey day walk away from kind of the epicenter where they spent most of their time, around Galilee, around, and then sometimes around Jerusalem, but around that region, two days away. They're on a walk. And then one of the followers of Jesus, who was a tax collector, he was someone who was employed by the Romans and then brought into as a follower of Jesus, he retells this story as he wrote it down after Jesus ascended into heaven. This is from Matthew. So this isn't some mystical book that J.R. Tolkien wrote. This is like one of the people who was walking around with Jesus telling about a conversation that he had with Jesus that is everything. It's a massive conversation. So we'll read this. Jesus came to Caesarea Philippi. There, he put this question to his disciples, the ones that were following them there. Who do people say that the Son of Man is, or the Son of God? John the Baptist, they replied. Others say Elijah. Some say Jeremiah, or one of those prophets, one of those powerful mouthpieces in the past. Well, what about you? That's what they say. What do you say? What do you guys say? That's what they say. What do you say? What do you say I am? Who do you say that I really am? And then Simon Peter, he answered. He jumped in. He answered. Kind of got louder. His voice got louder. You can see them all kind of chiming in. They're walking, right? Who are people saying that I am? Who are people saying that I am? Jeremiah, Moses, a prophet. They're saying all kinds of stuff. But what about you guys? What do you think? Who do you think I am? Am I just a mouthpiece? Am I just a powerful teacher? Am I just a presence? Who do you guys really think I am? I mean, you think it's that? Now, do you understand that to say that he was like that was to say he was like, in our culture, you might say, like George Washington, like one of the greatest founders, this amazing person that we care about, that we, you know, etch their face on a stone, and we go, that person was amazing. And people think you're basically at that level, you know? It's like LeBron James. Who do you think I am? You're basically like Michael Jordan. I mean, you are like that. You're at that level. So this wasn't like them criticizing Jesus. This was them knowing, saying to Jesus, like, everybody around knows that you are really, really important, and they don't even know you as well as we do. You are a big, big deal. And he's going, but do you know the difference between a big deal and a God deal? Can I get a hey, hey? Do you know the difference between a big deal and a God deal? Because I'm just no big deal. I'm a God deal. I'm a big, big time creator. I did it all, and it's more than that. Do you have that figured out yet? Because when you have that figured out, it means something. Like, it means a lot. It means a lot if you know who I am. Would you be like the kind of person that would raise your hand right now if you say, I know who Jesus is? Raise your hand. Yeah, right? You're like, whoa, you're thinking, maybe I don't. To know who Jesus is, to say it, to say he's the king, that's a big deal. Now, if you hear me say that and you're like, geez, I didn't think it was that big of a deal, you don't understand how big of a deal it is. And maybe you shouldn't be saying it. It's a big deal to say that Jesus is king. There have been times in my life where I felt like I shouldn't say that because the way I was living didn't look like Jesus was king. I believe that he's my king, and I believe that I'm his son, and I believe that I'm forgiven, and I believe that I've been brought in by his love. I believe that he considers me part of his family because I've trusted, and I know I'm not perfect. I know I won't do it all right, and I know that he forgives me. But there have been times where if someone asks me, are you his son, I'd be like, I'm not acting like it. And so one of the most important things you have to do as a Christ follower is every single day, remind yourself, who's the king of my life? Who is he? Who am I following? What about you? Simon Peter answered, you're the Messiah. Messiah, anointed, promised one is what that means. The promised one, he said, you are the son of the living God. You're the bloodline of the creator of the world. You're not just a prophet. You're not just a mouthpiece. You are the son of the living God. He stops. God's blessing on you, Simon, son of John. That's an exclamation point there. Saying that Jesus is king is a big deal. Jesus stops and he's like, hey, did everybody hear what Peter said? Did everybody hear it? Say it again, Peter, say it again. Tell him who I am. You're the Messiah. Tell him again, you're the Messiah. Oh, you're the king. Say it again. He starts to break it down. He's like, let's kick this. He starts to like just break out into like a Hamilton routine. Like he's like, that's it. Oh, blessings on you, Simon. You just declared that I am the promised king. That's a big deal. It's a big deal to follow Jesus. It's the biggest deal of your life. Who you follow, who you look to for how to think, how to talk, to help you with the wickedness inside, to help you with the wickedness out there, to really be your lifeblood, to give you hope, to give you peace. Oh man, there's nothing else. Like Carmen said, he's the bread of life. So if you declare him the bread of life, that's the beginning of life. That's a big deal. He says it's such a big deal that no person could have told you this. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that to you. It was my Father in heaven. And I've got something to tell you too. You are Peter, the rock. And on this rock, I will build my church. Everybody say, he said what? He said, what? I mean, you got to anchorman that, end it with a question mark. He said, what? I'm Ron Burgundy? Sorry. He said, what? You have to end high, right? You have to. That's the question mark. He said, what? And the gates of hell won't overpower it. Everybody say, he said, what? The gates of hell won't overpower it. What? What are you saying, Jesus? I will give you the keys to the kingdom. What is happening? What is going on? We just declared that Jesus is the king and he gave me the keys to the Bentley? He gave me the keys to the car? We're just following you out here on this dusty road and you just gave us the keys to the kingdom? You mean like the power? You mean like we have the access to the kingdom of God? That's what he goes on to say. So basically, if you have the keys to the kingdom, you have all the power in the world. And like as heaven and earth overlaps, you have tons of power. You're a follower. This is a big deal. You're in my kingdom. You're my people. And you're going to have great power in the world. So much power that the powers that are out there, like Rome and the powers of darkness and evil, that power, you will have more power than that. I'm going to give you have keys to have power over that. Because saying Jesus is king is a what? It's a big deal. I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Just think about them. Such a funny story the other day. Jet had to go to the doctor. I digress. I don't want to get into it all. He only had a common cold. Literally, the doctor wrote common cold. And he only had that. But the doctor said, I might need to give him a COVID test. And he freaked out. I don't want a COVID test. He didn't want the thing up his nose. I mean, obviously, who does? And he's like, I don't want that. And we said, okay, we're going to go home. And if you don't feel good tomorrow, you got to come back to the doctor and you have to take the COVID test. You have to do it. And he's like, no, I will not do it. I will not take the COVID test ever. And I literally said this verbatim. I said, Jet, I will buy you whatever you want. And he said to me, no. And I was like, The doctor, Dr. Kern, Gehenna Peach, some of you all know him. We all have the same doctor. He goes, now I am impressed with his strength. That is very interesting. He was just like, wow, like you just said that. And he said, no. So we're driving home and Jed is contemplating the whole scenario. And he's like, you know, Dad, I guess the one thing that you could give me to make me take that test is a Bentley. And I was like, no, it's not worth it. I mean, there's a whole lot more to that story, but do you understand the fact that he knew it was a Bentley? You know, they study all these cars and have all this stuff, and they're like, that's a big deal. He thought that. I just thought that was funny. Sorry, it said Bentley. It made me think of that. And untie, and you'll have all this power, and you untied in heaven and on earth. And then 20, then he sternly ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Isn't that interesting? It's such a big deal to call him the Messiah, but he didn't want anyone to tell anybody that yet. Why would Jesus say it's such a big deal? It's life-changing. You're going to have all these keys. He kind of makes it sound, doesn't it? Like, he makes it sound like everyone's going to know you. You're going to be like marching with the authority, with the flags, and in step with representing all the power that you have. That's going to be who you are, but don't tell anybody. Why? Why does he say not tell anybody? You know why? The whole talk this morning, calling Jesus King is a big deal. And what Jesus knew is that in the context, and that's why he went 2 days away from where they normally spent their time, 2 days away, he takes them to this more private place where they can have a very important conversation where the pressure is released. Because if you called someone King or Messiah, you know, if you said that's Jesus or he's the Messiah, which the people of Israel and the leadership knew that there was supposed to be a king that came from Nazareth that was born of the line of David, and Jesus fit those boxes. So now if he's doing miracles and he's saying things and teaching and he has a following and he says, I'm a king, then leadership is going to get, like, scared. And they are probably going to attack Jesus, which they eventually do, and kill him. And his disciples, which they scatter before they get their hands on him. So Jesus, what he's doing is he's taking them away into a safe place, kind of like we're doing this today. You know, it's like, here we are, it's a safe place. Calling me king should mean a lot. It will mean that your life is potentially going to go into harm's way. Now, today, contextually, that doesn't always mean that, right? Like, in there's some celebration of people knowing Jesus. And I would say that for the first time in my lifetime, it feels like there's more hostility towards Christians than ever before. That if you call yourself a Christ follower, that now there's all kinds of things that aren't true, that are bad, that get tied to that, and a lot of really good things that it means despite what the world says. However, at this time, calling Jesus King meant you might die for this. You might have to lose everything for this. And so what Jesus is doing is he's pulling them away, and he's saying, I'm the Messiah, and you following me is a big deal. And he gets his title from his first church, his first group of followers. And they call him King. It's a big deal, and it's going to be a big deal when other people do. And he says that calling Jesus a Messiah is such a big deal that idea, that truth, that saying, that's what he's going to use as the building block to grow a global movement of people who are followers of Jesus and part of the kingdom of God. That's a big deal. Do you know there are people on other continents right now who are declaring with their hands in the air, Jesus is the King? You don't speak their language. You don't believe all of their religious customs. You believe the same thing about Jesus. The power of the unifying confession that Jesus is King is the largest movement in the history of the world. And you're a part of it. You're a part of that. That's amazing that he let us be a part of that, because the next part is the part that blows all of our minds. How in the world are we a part of this amazing thing that God has called us into? The church. Calling Jesus means it's going to be difficult. Who do people say? They just say he's a mouthpiece. Who we say? He's the master. He's the Messiah. He's the King. And he brings everybody in to his world and says, you're going to be my followers. You're going to be my church. You're going to be my building that's not a building. You get the picture here with Peter. He says, oh, you said that? That's a big deal. And then he says, your name is Peter, which means little rock. Your name means Peter. And then he says, but upon this rock, and he uses the word for big rock, I'm going to build my church. And what he's saying is that on the confession of Jesus as the king, I'm going to build the ecclesia. That's where the word church shows up. Jesus says it for the first time. Ecclesia, it's the gathering of people who follow Jesus. I'm going to build my gathering. I'm going to build my movement. It was a term that was used for armies and political movements. I'm going to build my gathering around the name of Jesus because of the confession that Jesus is king. So I'm going to build that. And what he's saying to Peter is he's saying, look at the city of Jerusalem, Herod's temple, these giant stones that the whole thing was built upon. And he's basically using all this inner wordplay where he's telling the disciples, he said, they build kingdoms, Rome builds kingdoms, even Israel, you guys, you build kingdoms on stones, like on you build buildings and you build streets and you build these cities and that's what you build your kingdom. And the bigger that is, then the bigger your kingdom is, and the more cities that you overrun and lead, then you're stronger. That's what muscularity is in kingdom world. And he says, I'm not even going to build my kingdom on buildings. I'm going to build my kingdom on the connection and the multiplication and the growth and the manifestation of human hearts all around the globe. He says, on you, Peter, you, your heart. And then as that transforms into their heart and their heart and their heart and their heart and all those people together, different nations, different tongues, different color skin, then they all say, Jesus is king. That's my church. And he's called us all into that. And you may think, I don't deserve to be a part of that. And we might all have reasons that we're not. You think, I don't deserve to be a part of it. And this is the part I want to encourage you today. I want to encourage you today because Jesus goes and says that statement, right? He says, then the gates of hell won't prevail against that global movement of hearts unified around the kingship of Jesus. Nothing's going to stand. The gates of hell, the powers of darkness won't be able to stop that. And when you think about the powers of darkness, what do you think about? What do you think about the powers of darkness? You think about, you know, different movements, evil. You think about horrific things that are happening in countries with people. You think about relationships. You think about all the awful stuff, lying and killing and just the horrific things that are happening even in this city all around, you know, people getting shot. It's awful. You think about those evil things. And one of the lessons to take away from this is that Jesus has called you into his kingdom even though you and I are oftentimes the people that bring the hell to church. You're still a part of it. Isn't that crazy? We think about hell, the way things aren't supposed to be, evil, the way it is out there, it's bad. And we think God's church will push more on that than it pushes. As it leans, it will win that battle. It'll win the battle of the trenches. And Jesus is saying that, but he's also saying that even you, my followers, as the darkness that this world has to offer seeps into your souls, the emptiness that you have at times, the evil that you as my followers, I'm still gonna use you. I'm still gonna use you. Because he says to Peter on the confession of Jesus as king and the fellowship of him, I'm gonna build my church. You know what the next phrase, the next interaction is? Jesus, right after he says, I'm gonna build my kingdom, he says this is crazy. He's like, I'm going to build a kingdom. I'm going to build it and all. We're going to have this gathering. And you just get this sense that the disciples are thinking, this is going to be great. This is going to be this great movement. There's conversation with Jesus later about who's going to be at the right and left hand of Jesus on the throne. Like, who's going to be like his right-hand man? Who's going to be his vice president? Who's going to be his, you know, his right-hand man? They're wondering who's going to be the treasurer. They're trying to build this whole system of government and how, you know, where they're going to sit and what color robe they're going to have. That's what they're thinking. The next thing Jesus says is he starts talking to his disciples and he says, yeah, I'm going to have to go to Jerusalem and get arrested, beaten, and crucified. And they're like, huh? He said what? Like you just said you're the king and we're going to church, ecclesia, gathering. I thought we were going to be this movement. What about the keys thing, Jesus? I thought we were going to have the keys to build and grow. And he's like, oh, you are. I'm giving you all that. I'm going to give you that. But then look what happens. Peter grabs Jesus and he takes Jesus aside. This is the next part. Jesus starts saying, I'm going to die. And Peter pulls Jesus aside to basically challenge Jesus on his first big declaration as the new king in their life. And he challenges Jesus. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Never, Lord, you just said you're the king. He said, this shall never happen to you. Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me. Say that word. Satan. He said, what? He just called Peter Satan before he said, on the rock, you rock, build people, hearts, I'm going to grow you. Now you are being called Satan. It's on the same page, unless you have a weirdly printed Bible. It's on the same page. I'm going to build my church on the confession that Peter just made that God blessed him with. We're going to build this global movement. Wait a minute, I'm going to go and die because they didn't understand what he had to do, and that's what we celebrate and talk about at Easter. So if you don't have your mind wrapped around the cross and why, you don't have your mind wrapped around the resurrection and why, come back to Easter. Let's recalibrate what Jesus is getting at here. It's very difficult to wrap your mind around. He didn't understand what Jesus had to do and what real leadership and kingship looked like. So he challenges him and he says, get behind me, Satan. You can't get in the way of who I'm going to be. And what this is Jesus then basically says, hey, as a follower of me, you need to be a building block, not a stumbling block. You need to be a building block, not a stumbling block. You need to be a path maker for Jesus. You need to remember that even though, Peter, you are full of sin and you do evil things and you say things you shouldn't say and you were already, I just told you I'm going to use you to grow my church, but you mess up. I'm still going to use you to grow the church. Can anybody in here just say thank you to God? That he uses us even though we're broken. That he lets us be a part of building his church even though we become a stumbling block. How many people would just be honest with me and I'll be the first to raise my hand? Who brings the hell to church sometimes? It's not just out there, is it? It's right here. It's my heart. It's your heart. It's our hearts. And God, in his grace to build his movement, to build this kingdom, he just wraps us up and uses us and lets us be a part of it. He transforms us. Is anybody wondering why this broom is right here? The other day, Reading has this sandbox toy. That's the one toy I'm like, please don't do the sandbox. Because it's a mess all the time. And like you learn as a parent, you're like, okay, I'll pick my battle. The sand is fine because she's occupied with sand. But she has this sandbox and she spilled it all over the garage. And I was taking the trash out. One thing, I wasn't thinking straight. I made a rookie mistake. And instead of using the outdoor broom, does anybody have an outdoor broom? I have two outdoor brooms. The push one, the normal one. And then you got the indoor broom, right? And you all know it's a cardinal sin, right? To use that indoor broom outside. Not okay. But I did it. I went inside. I got the indoor broom. I started sweeping up the sand in the garage. I'm sweeping up the sand, right? Got it all sweeped up just like this. This isn't the one. This is from here. But this is exactly what it was. It has the dustpan. I put it back around.